And a little bit about what we're doing tonight is just sort of opening up a dialogue. We're going to have a couple of moments, maybe 10 or 15 minutes, where these guys will talk about the work they're doing now. As you can see, this is all Pete Hawkins' show, which opened last Friday night, and then Helen's show opens in 2 weeks, and we've got a couple of people. We swapped out a few pieces from Pete's show so that we have relevant works, and that's on July 20th, so 2 more weeks. And also other artists who show, Julie Smith, so happy to have you here, but Julie also shows at the gallery. We're just going to talk a little bit and let you guys ask some questions. It's a conversation about creative practice, and I love these guys. We're a painter's gallery, and I say that a lot, and because we're a gallery that's really about shop talk and process, and we are that kind of space, we like that. As a, my mother, who is an artist herself, and really the sort of creator of this house and this space, without your support, this gallery wouldn't exist at all. But I think that as a painter, who's a daughter of a painter, just that's what I want this gallery to be about. So I want this gallery to be a place for conversation about the process. So here we go. And you can read all, and you guys, we're all friends. We're all visit, so you can ask and read about all their stuff, their bios and all that stuff. But we're keeping it.
Thank you, Liz, and thank you, Madeline, for enabling Liz to create this space. And it's an amazing opportunity. I think I can speak for both of us to say that we're really grateful for the opportunity to be in the show here. When we talked about this, we thought it would be useful for each of us to talk for maybe 2 or 3 minutes about our creative practice, and inclusive of things other than just painting. Then we might respond to one another. Then we'll talk a little bit again for 2 or 3 minutes about being in place and really open it up to all of your questions and work. So Helen's going to start by talking about her creative practice in a bit.
Well, that's a very broad term. So we talked earlier about, well, what does that mean, creative? I realize it actually can mean almost anything. So when I think about it, what it means for me, I think it starts with just being willing to make a commitment to do the work. And so it's not about waiting for the right inspiration or that perfect moment. It's about being willing to just move paint around and get process going no matter what. But then within that, it's definitely, I'm fortunate now that I have my studio in my home, which is actually kind of a mixed blessing in some ways, but the beauty of it is that I can stop and suddenly see something that I've been trying to figure out for a long time, and then I have 20 minutes and I can just do it, and then I have to go, but then I can come back to it. And so I realize that my process is just like trying to chisel away. Then we were earlier talking about things that influence us, that might influence our creative process and, you know, the things that we do in life. And of course, that brings it right back to this place and any season. But that is something that, just so I'm happy to say that when I go to the beach, that's part of the creative process. Because I'm soaking it all in, and that's what's going to come out later, maybe at night or. Listening to this place and accessing that piece of me which connects to place. So whether it's just for a moment or hours, ideally, or not.
That's great. So, I'm glad you mentioned 2 things, work and going to the beach.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, that's really part of what I wanted to talk about as well. One of the things, I'm sort of notorious for being a fast painter, and so people who know the gallery will know that suddenly I'll show up with a bunch of work and where they come from. And that's because, like Helen said, my work happens not in the studio, it happens other places. So the studio is really the last part of making buildings for me. And in some ways, this is gonna sound ridiculous, but it's in some ways the sort of least labor intensive, because it's not where the work happens. That's where the joy of expressing the work comes out. But I'm a big part of my practice is walking. So in the summer, it's not unusual for me to walk 15 or 20 miles a day. And part of that is just embedding myself in this landscape. And people often say to me, like, oh, come to like Berkshires. It's a beautiful place to play paint too. And I'm like, well, I'd have to go and spend like a year walking around before I'd be ready to make a painting. And so a big part of my practice is embedding myself in this place. Another part of my practice that's maybe invisible in paintings is I'm a teacher. And people immediately will say, oh, you teach painting. You know, for the first time in years, I'll be teaching painting this summer at the museum down the street, and I don't teach painting. I actually mostly work with performing artists and literary artists. And that's because where I teach, Goddard College, the Master of Fine Arts program, allows students to choose their teachers rather than their teachers to put classes together. You know, people choose the classes. So it's performing artists who want to work with me because I speak about their work as performers, like a visual artist, and that's useful to them. And so I think that dialogue between different forms, I'm not a performance artist, but I do performance creation. By much, but I think that the dialogue is a really important part of my practice and how I think about making a painting and how I think about things like composition from working with composers or choreography of space because I work with dancers. So, do you want to talk a little bit more maybe about this place and why this place is important?
Okay. Well, when I was little, I lived outside of Boston, but we always came to the Deep. And then when I was in ninth grade, I moved out here full time, and I went to Nauset. And so I feel like this place is part of me from when I was young. And I think many of us in this room have that feeling where you retreat in. Find your safe places, and that's the cave, that's the dunes, that's the beach, that's walking in the woods. For me right now, what's going on with my art is it's getting more abstracted, and I've been trying to capture that connection to place, not necessarily representationally, but more emotionally. And so that's color and shape and composition. Yeah. And it's also becoming really about layering. So what I've been thinking of is the abstracted bit is actually thinking shells has been a theme of mine since I was kind of just found some artwork from when I was in high school and it was shells, more shells. So all these years and different ways of trying to keep it relevant to where I'm at right now and. So abstracted, but then I keep going back to the natural world, and I've been really happy to be thinking about the shells as though looking through the water and light bending, and the idea that water is just, it's in constant motion, and so your perception of what you're looking at is shifting all the time. It's never the same for more than a moment. And so sometimes my paintings, like I'll put something down and it'll come to fruition pretty quickly, but other times I have to just keep going, like my angle keeps changing and I'm looking and I'll go back the next day and I'll turn it upside down and do it again. And so it's a process of layering too. And so it depends on where I'm at. And sometimes it feels really strongly connected to a certain place or weather or season. Other times it has to go through all those changes to get to the place where it's supposed to be.
Dialogue with you?
I would like that.
Let's move to that section of
So when grabbing was, you talked about how your paintings are becoming more abstract, and I've been a follower of your work and since the first show of yours.
that I attended, which was at the Winchester tattoo shop. And I have painting from that collection. And so I've seen it go more abstract, and I love it. And I'm wondering, can you articulate, or do you have a sense, and can you articulate that sense of when, where, why, and how you made that shift from the stuff that I recall, which was more representational, but still a little, nonetheless, a little abstract, but now it's gone in a whole other.
Well, it's funny because I kind of, it's like a pendulum swing for me, because I had, like, the body of work now that I'm showing is abstract, but I still always go back to, especially like February, March, this representational thing where I'll pull out the box of shells that I gathered and just start painting them. So I feel like that's an important piece for me, but then there's, from there, it's like letting go or loosening up or not getting hung up on it being something representational and more just trying to like strip all that stuff away and just have that feeling. So yeah, but just the past few years, that's just felt more and more important, but at the same time, I keep going back to
that's interesting.
The whole
you
circle.
Go, you go back. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
How long have you been a painter?
Well, I graduated from art school in 89, and since then, yeah.
How about you? How long have you been?
I think it's fair to say since I was like 16, although when you were talking about coming here, you know, moving here as a teenager, when the summer I was 13, my parents dropped me off at my mother's cousin's house in South Wellfleet, and there was some stuff going on at home that they needed to deal with. And my mother's cousin would take a nap in the afternoon, and I would just get on my bicycle at 10 speed, and I'd ride up here to the Provincetown. And no one would believe that I could go that far on my bicycle, so I got away with all sorts of stuff, because I would just go places on my bicycle. Where have you been? I went to, you couldn't possibly have gotten there. Okay. and I remember that summer thinking, I want to live here and be a painter of this landscape. It was like this obsession.
Yeah.
I took all these photographs of my little Instamatic camera, and I remember getting them back from the drugstore and being so depressed. And my mother just looked at me and said, "Your camera doesn't have any depth of field. Of course you didn't get anything interesting." And so some of you know, I spent the last 6 months attending to my mom's final stage of life. And so the show, in a large way, is a manifestation of that 13-year-old's sort of impulse. And the places are the places my mother took me. And you know, the show, in some ways, is about the lineage of her coming here for the first time in 1936. And interestingly enough, my mother is the person who least wanted me to be a painter. Like, she was the one who wanted me to be a lawyer. And, you know, and it kept coming up. So it's a funny sort of thing of the, like, when? Well, when I was 13, I wanted to do it. When I was 16, I got paints. And then it took me until I was 52 to actually make those paintings.
Yeah.
And I'm not sure I've made them yet, you know, so.
So I've only been familiar with your work very happily in the last couple of years, I would say, maybe three at the most. So I don't have any sense of what your previous work is. Is there some kind of continuity or lack of continuity that you can describe?
Well, some of my neighbors from Rhode Island are here, and they will tell you that for 15 years I made these large figurative paintings that were nothing like this at all.
Oh, okay. That's interesting. That's
so interesting. I think it's fair to say that that work was an examination of like an interior landscape,
right.
And now I'm looking to the world.
Yeah. I feel like I'm doing the opposite. Well, yeah, I mean, I'm using the exterior world all these years, and now I'm using that as a way to paint my interior world. Yeah, my emotions in response to, yeah, it's about what we feel. Yeah, and what how long have you been a painter? Well, that it changes all the time what that means too, doesn't it?
That's right.
Maybe for me that means when I've started like moving the paint around instead of being scared of it. Excited and wanting to do it, but more timid. And you get to a point where you realize you just have to be able to destroy it to move forward.
Yeah.
Have
either of you had periods of time when you were, or the longest period of time is you when you've gone without painting at all, when you just didn't pick up brush, anything in your 30 years or 30 plus years?
So I have this horrible habit of people, other artists will come up and say, oh, well, are you working? And I'll be like, oh no, I haven't worked at all. And then I'll be like, except for those 36 paintings I made 6 months ago. And so there are these periods like of months that I don't work, but I don't think there's ever been a period of my life where I stepped away from.
Big distinction that work is not necessarily the actual picking up of the brush, but there is this experience of picking up the brush and not. So I ask because I'm under and going through a period of not going through lots of
money. Yeah.
So.
I'd also say those periods where I haven't picked up a brush, I'm still working.
Yeah. Yeah.
And the work evolves. I always worry that like, oh, it's been 6 months, I'm gonna be bad. Like I'll have forgotten everything. Like, but somehow you start again and you haven't stopped progressing.
Mm-hmm.
Like
mm-hmm.
Jump in.
I have an observation about that. I think that as an artist, don't you have these times where you're a sponge and you absorb and then you squeeze it out? And then you're a sponge and then you squeeze it out. And so you have to absorb for however long and then you go back to work again.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah.
How are you?
Can you guys, I know you touched on it a little bit, but the idea of abstraction. Can you just talk about that? I know you connected your feelings with it, but you didn't start off being an abstract painter, or should we call it, abstract representation?
Right, yeah.
Both of you?
Yes.
And I'm wondering, maybe what you're thinking when you're doing your work, when I look out at something and I want to paint it, how are you forming the idea of abstraction as it goes from your eyes to your hand? I'm kind of interested in that, if you can even articulate that.
I think it's for me personally, actually being an abstract artist, it seems almost impossible. And something that I'm so wanting to do at the same time, it's, and still, I mean, this painting is pretty abstract, but it's so grounded, like I was saying, in this idea of it's representational at the same time. And I have a hard time of letting go of that piece and just purely being abstract. So, but like I say, I kind of want to do that. So it's this ongoing thing for me that I haven't figured out yet.
It's a conversation.
Yeah, yeah.
So when you talk about your interest in shells and then, sorry.
Are you going to change the subject? Because I was waiting for pizza to have a question too.
Oh, okay.
Not at all.
Shells, hold us.
Yeah.
Oh, that's shell. So I actually, I don't really see a difference between abstraction and figuration. I had a really marvelous drawing teacher in college. In college I really wanted to be as tight as possible and get that representation of the thing. I really wanted to be that kind of person who could draw it perfectly. And Bryce required us to use like red, yellow, and blue washes with a big brush and to make really fast drawings of whatever we were assigned. So it might be the figure, it might be our feet, it might be a hand, it might be a self-portrait. It might be like a jar on the floor. And you'd have to make 50 of them in an hour. And we, you know, and I really resisted it because I wanted to, you know, where's my pencil? And he just said, have faith. If you just keep doing this, you will be able to draw anything you want, anywhere you want to draw. And I was like, yeah, well, whatever. I have to take your class. But after 6 weeks of it, like a full day for 6 weeks, suddenly I could draw anything I wanted in any way that I wanted to. Because the process of abstracting that way had taught me how to connect my hand and my eye to see. So now the question becomes for me, how is it that I'm arranging patterns of energy on a field? And my work really is about patterns of energy in the landscape. It's not necessarily about abstraction, it's not necessarily about figuration. But like Helen's saying, it's like the feeling of being in the place. Shells.
Yeah, so shells. So you were talking about your, you know, interest in shells and also being on the Cape. So that connects me with what this abstract painting is about. Okay? But you brought colors that I don't see in the, you know, if I'm looking down into the water. It's like the colors are pumped up so much higher. How did you do that?
It's like flashes of color bouncing off of the water is okay. How it is for me. Yeah, just from the world. And sometimes when I'm painting, I put the canvas on the floor and I imagine that I'm looking down into the water and seeing the different layers through.
So that's done in your studio.
Yes.
Okay.
Do you take photographs ever of what you're painting, or do you do it all with shells in your studio?
Shells in the studio. Okay. Yeah. When I do landscapes, yeah, I haven't done photographs in a long time, though I have on occasion. But more when I paint landscapes, I'll go out and then maybe I'll bring it back to the studio and tweak it and change it. But then this kind of stuff is really in the studio.
He's playing.
I wanted to ask Jim the same question. Maybe I missed this because I came late, but how much is done from direct observation and how much is done in your studio? Do you use sketches or photographs?
I very rarely go out and plein air paint. Helen and I were with a few other people in the gallery last summer, going out one day a week. And it was a great experience, but it's not how I make paintings. I do use photographs as references, but photographs as references are always a starting place. And what's more important is the experience of being in that place and being able to recall the memory of the place in the body. Because photographs that are reproduced as paintings are just bad reproductions of photographs, but they provide a structure.
Composition.
Well, and a prompt for memory.
Yeah.
The whole history of photography is being about memory. That's how photographs work for me.
I'm curious about the plein air work that you did. How would you compare it to your usual work? Like, how did it come out different from usual stuff?
Well, I mean, plein air painting is, the process is laborious. You have to, the whole setup, you know, is a thing. And depending on how far out you go, you know, you maybe can carry one or two panels of canvases with you. And so it becomes about the process, for me at least, in some ways. I think when I've been most successful as a plein air painter is when I've turned my vehicle into a mobile studio. So when I was in college, I had a sedan and I would take out the bucket seat of the passenger and just put it in my basement. And then I'd sit in the back seat and have an easel in the front seat. And you could work for hours and days and you could, you know, transport a lot of work with you. And it was really productive. I'd rather be walking in the landscape and then come back and translate my memory than be out there. So it's not that the paintings for me necessarily are that different, but the experiences.
I want to say something about plein air painting. I'm also a plein air painter. The relationship of photography to plein air painting also in art history is so important that it was the introduction of the daguerreotype that had artists, I think, call the question, like, what is it that I'm making? What's the relevance if there is something that can, quote, capture reality, and that birth of impressionism. So it's really wonderful to think of the subversion of that, how you're painting, you're using photographs and then making those paintings that feel like kind of paintings. So that's really wonderful. One of the great things about a gallery of painters is that you guys, we can have these types of dialogues when we go into, oh, and you know, Arthur Cohen, remember he had that painting studio in his car where he turned the steering wheel into almost like a wooden sculptural object that had pegs that fit different size tiny canvases. And I used to use a bicycle as a painting studio where I had a kitty carrier. I didn't have a baby, but I had a lot of babies that were paintings. And in my 20s, I rode around in a bicycle with a kitty head. So I just wanted to say, like, I love this style. I'm not really asking any questions. I'm just throwing in some ideas and thoughts because you're stimulating your brain and to memories that and little art historical moments. And so, that's all.
I've been on many walks with you, and you take a lot of pictures. And so, obviously, I know you work in photographs, but it's interesting. It's amazing to me how much they don't look like paintings made from photographs, even though, like, they really do express the moment when the photograph was taken. So I appreciate that. That contrast of, I mean, it looks more like you would have done it plein air, because it captures that moment.
Yes, right.
Well, again, it's that lesson my mother taught me. There's no depth of field.
Right.
You know, my iPhone. And there's only so much that you can do there. But your body remembers.
Yeah.
And, you know, part of it is just putting yourself in the space of being back there. Another one of my teachers, right after I worked with him, two or three years after I graduated, developed macular degeneration. And he was one of the best watercolorists of his generation. He was highly detailed, beautiful, you know, complicated paintings. And he couldn't do that anymore. He started to make these large scale, remembered landscapes. And they were incredible. And you know, he would put himself in that kind of state of mind of being back in these places that over the 60 odd years of his life to that point he had been in. You know, worked for 20 years that way.
And memory shifting sand.
Yeah.
Do you ever take notes? Like, so you take photographs, you do a lot of walking. Do you ever take notes that you come back and make notations about the light that day or the sky or the ocean?
No.
That's
a nice idea.
That's a great idea.
Yeah. Also, I know that you, some of your paintings, you paint the canvas red. Do you do that with all of your paintings?
Most of them.
And why?
You paint the canvas what? Red?
Why do you do that?
Well, it's either, it's usually like a red or an orange. And there's a Renaissance technique that you'd use Venetian red to prime the canvases for one reason of layering to create luminosity. But for landscape painters, orange works because primarily your landscape is blue or green, and so it creates a vibration in the flex of the orange that comes through. So you're working with, you know, the red and the green are one complementary set, and the orange and the blue are a different complementary set. And I use I generally use something that in one light looks orange and in another light looks red. So.
You've got such a great Instagram feed.
Yeah.
I really have been loving all this stuff, especially as you were going through the process with your mom. What you were just saying about remembrance,
mm-hmm.
like when I looked at some of your images, I failed that. And so like you, even though it was your iPhone and two-dimensional, you really did capture something beyond just the moment. It brought me back to memories of my childhood in a very similar kind of setting.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, I think that the iPhone is an amazing tool. And if you go to my Instagram feed and you look at what it says, I think the first thing it says is, this is visual research. And so my Instagram feed is work, it's labor. It's part of being an artist for me, and it's about collecting, and it's about looking. I'm not one of those people who says that the camera is creates a distance between you and your experience, and the camera allows you to frame your experience and to create emotion through that framing. I'm constantly looking in both places, but I'm also creating archives. So again, when I decide that I want to work in Wellfleet, because that's where my mom introduced me, to the ocean, I've got thousands of images from walking on those dunes, and I can just go through that archive and find them, and that's my note taker.
Yeah.
That if I'm like, oh, there was that day that was transcendent in this way, remember that moment? Like, just go back and find those photographs, and that becomes the starting point. David Hockney, the British painter, has done a lot of writing about photographic images in relationship to painting. And painters cannot work today without some relationship to the photograph. Mm-hmm. The photograph is just so pervasive in our culture. But we don't perceive like photographs do. Photographs are like one lens, we've got binocular vision. We're constantly moving around, the camera is still. And so when you're making a painting, you have to remember that you're constantly moving around, receiving that space. And you're trying to make something that's more interesting in some ways than a photograph. Gerhard Richter, who's a German painter, has riffed off the whole painting is dead to say that photography is dead. And I actually believe him. It's hard to see a photograph today and remember it. There are no iconic photographs being made the way there were in, before 1985, that we all know, because we're saturated by the photographic image. We're so saturated we can't see them anymore. But painting forces us to stop and invites us to look and to listen again. And so I think that that's why painting will never die, because it's the subjectivity of it, like what you're saying.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's
the living thing. It's alive. I was just thinking about when you're painting and laying color down it's that you work with performance and that you work with humans in your other job, right? You work in the care of giving care. But there is this about, it is very aesthetic. It is the opposite of an aesthetic. It is a lot.
Yes.
And I feel that in your paintings. So you both just, I'm so honored to have you show here.
I haven't. I was just thinking about that last night. I just got invited to teach a course in the fall, and I'm trying to think about what to do. And I was like, oh, maybe portraits would be interesting.
And I love your portrait work, and it's been really interesting to watch.
I think one of the reasons that it looks so plein air, and open it is because it's so spontaneous and it has such immediacy. I'm wondering how, if you're doing it in the studio, how do you know when to stop? How do you stop yourself from getting detail and fussy?
Question.
How do you know how to stop?
I don't always, and sometimes I definitely overwork it, and then darn, I missed that moment. I have to scrape it all down and start again. but sometimes, all of a sudden, you put a certain color somewhere, and it's like, oh, that's what it needed. I don't know, just that's one, I guess. But also my process is definitely, like I was saying earlier, I put in a chunk of time and then I get to walk away and then come circle around back. Or I have a lot of paintings going at once. Okay, I have this problem and I can't quite figure it out, but I can figure it out in this other painting, which is different but has the same issue, and then I can circle it back. And sometimes I think I'm going to circle it back, and then I realize, oh, actually, I think it's done.
I think one of the great things about Liz and the gallery is that she will let me put work up, and then I will come back to it maybe a couple weeks later, and I'll say, I've got to pull this and work on it more.
Yeah.
Which is really wonderful being part of a painter's gallery, that sometimes I stop too soon, but sometimes, like Helen says, you go too far and it collapses.
Mm-hmm.
But that just means you have to get back to the place where it rebuilds itself. Mm-hmm. And it really is this the cycle. You get it to the sweet spot, and hopefully you know when to stop. And sometimes you don't, because you're in a bad mood, or you need a cup of coffee, or whatever.
You need to
collapse
walk away,
it.
But you don't.
Yeah, and it collapses, you know, and you have to find your way back.
Yeah.
And again, this is where memory is really important, that you have to remember that there was this sweet spot that you loved it.
Mm-hmm.
And
what I end up sometimes doing is wanting to paint too many paintings in one on one canvas.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, and start you. I have like a colors thing going that I want to do, and then I get excited about this little corner, and then if I'm not careful, I have like rework the whole thing because that little corner, and really you gotta just walk away and do that little corner thing on another painting.
Well, my last big project before I moved here was a project where I made 100 portraits. And it was this project that I started, and I was like, yeah, I need to make 100 portraits. And a curator was really interested in it. And like for years, I was like, yeah, maybe 100 portraits. And I'm like, I'm 27. And, it was this side project. You know, when I had some time, I'd make a couple portraits. And he emailed me one day and he said, your opening is on July 22nd. You have until then to get the 100 portraits done. And it was February. And I had to make 100 portraits. You remember this?
Yeah, I do.
And we live across an alley from one another, and my studio door opens essentially to where
being the nosy neighbor.
Yeah. And those portraits, I couldn't spend more than 30 minutes to an hour on each portrait, because I had to get them done. And that's a really good. I got much much better at painting portraits for doing that. But left to my own devices, I might take weeks on one. And again, the question of like how quickly it comes together, it's like, it's 6 hours and 37 years, you know? And so it's like, it's all of that is coming with you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, because I paint several paintings at once, sometimes it'll be three paintings that I'm kind of struggling with, and it's weeks and weeks, and then I'll start another one, and in 2 days I'll be like, oh, I'm done with that. So it can vary wildly. Yeah.
And that's another thing about plein air painting as a discipline. It does help you to make work more quickly in some ways, at least for me, because you're racing against the light,
mm-hmm.
and you can come back, but that's a different kind of commitment.
Or in the case of
Anya
Swoldenkova, who's our newest artist, who's showing here, the two pieces up here, the top one was done during one of the hurricanes, and she was literally, the paintings were blowing them up. So, that's a really, again, like, thing that happens with painters is they have to contend with the environment.
Elements.
Yeah, 100 painters, or it puts everything right on edge. You have to be fighting the elements. We did do some flyer painting us here, and maybe we could do, is at the end of the season, do another event kind of like this, but out in the field. Because, you know, why not? Because we pulled this together for rather quickly, and I think it would be wonderful to do something like this in the landscape instead of a hot room.
Yeah.
We could do this in the landscape with some invite people to come and paint. So stay tuned.
I mean, I feel a little bit of a hypocrite. I am teaching at the museum this summer, and for 2 hours in the morning, I'm taking everyone out to make 5 small paintings in the landscape, and then we're coming back after lunch to work in the studio to develop, larger scale paintings from what we develop in the landscape. So, I mean, it's not like I've got a problem with plein air painting. It's, the discipline of it is really important in some ways.
Yeah.
And I think because I have done it in the past so much, those experiences.
Well, I think we're similar in that way, where sometimes the discipline of working representationally and more traditionally is like you just have to like work through that stuff to, then the next step is to let it go, and shave it down to some elements of that.
So maybe at this point we should say thank you.
So I love that painting in the back, the very light blue one. When was that done? And it's so different from this one. I was like, that is not a Helen trip. But it is. I see the shells. So can you talk about the differences? Like how you went from there to here? Was
yeah, this that was actually one that was not long before this one. And yeah, it was a few months ago. Maybe it was February. It was winter time, and I was imagining that it was warm. I remember that.
That's good.
But it wasn't too long after the one above it is also sort of like a wintry thing. And so I was noticing when I was looking back over the season, the winter, how my palette really changed as spring came at last, and then I was getting more and more color until I ended up with this. So that was a big part of it, the season changing.
This seems a little more wintry, a little bit darker.
That's interesting.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I've been an admirer of your paintings of Heron Cove, of Rhodes. When you do a painting of a landscape, and then the landscape continues to change, perhaps to a point of irrecognizability afterwards, does your relationship with the piece you did change? You've answered this to a great extent already, but to what extent does the painting become its own entity separate from what was previously observed?
Yeah, I think that's, we've talked a lot about the emotional tenor in paintings, but I see those paintings really as coming out of a documentary tradition that, I walk the Herring Cove North parking lot eroded away 2 winters ago really dramatically. We go every day, and these large pieces of asphalt would float in different ways through the storms, and they had these yellow lines on them. So it was really recognizable as graphic images and shapes. And I made, probably 30 of those paintings. I feel really emotionally embedded in that moment in time. I mean, ironically, I never really liked the north part of Heron Cove before it broke up. I would never go to that parking lot when it was in full shape. It just was there's something very urban about that beach because it's like a road right on the beach. But once it started breaking up, I was like, oh, I'm all about this. it really connected me to the place. So thank you all for coming and your questions. We'll be around and I think happy to answer any other questions.
Thank you very much.
Yes.
Thank you. refreshments.